So I'm here at Prismic Studio, and I'm here with Tim, lead developer at Next.
Yep.
Tim, how long have you been working on Next?
Pretty much since it came out, but I was mostly an external contributor until recently, like 1.5 years ago. So Next was started like 2 years ago, sort of, or 2.5. I'm not entirely sure, like from the top of my mind, but end of 2016.
Right.
And yeah, I've been involved with the project for a very long time.
So the reason I thought of inviting you here is that for a lot of our users, basically, to the specificities of what we provide, like we don't provide the front end as a CMS, we only provide the back end.
Right.
And a lot of users, then they ask like, which framework should we be using, right?
Right.
And I really think Next is a very viable solution for a lot of their cases. And I thought like, you know, why not have you here to tell us about why is it available for this kind of use cases where basically they build websites,
right?
With content, and then the website evolve in different directions,
right?
Can you tell us why Next is a good solution for these kind of cases?
So generally, when you start building a web application, for example, you start out with maybe static pages, right? So you build your remarketing pages, like your homepage and your about page, your terms of service, that kind of thing. And generally, like once your application starts growing, you want to do something more dynamic. For example, you want to do product pages that have like data from your CMS coming in, maybe like the live stock updates, that kind of thing. And Next.js allows you to actually like switch between those, so between static rendering and server-side rendering on a per-page basis. So every route of your application, so your homepage could be a static website, and then your product pages could be dynamic, for example.
So wait, do I need routes to start working with Next?
So the way that it works is you create a pages directory, which is it works in a similar way to PHP, for example. So if you ever use PHP, you create a folder and you put in your PHP files and it just works, right?
Right.
So with Next, we provide a similar solution, but for React, which means that you create a pages directory and you put in a file, which is, for example, your about.js, which maps to /about automatically.
Mm-hmm. So once I did this, I have my page running. And then if I want to add some content that comes from, not statically, but from another source,
right,
like a CMS or a database, how would I do that?
So what you do is you create a React component, just a normal React component as you would generally do. So then you add in a method called getInitialProps, which is a static method on pages that is asynchronously executed and waited for before rendering. So
before rendering, this
before rendering, you fetch some data from anywhere, which could be an API, for example, or a headless CMS, and after that, it starts rendering. So after that, we render the actual components and like the content of the page.
So basically, the way I understand it, you have a page directory, you make a file for that page, and then if you want to fetch data from somewhere else, you get initial props, and then you have data you can render. And you mentioned that it uses React.
Yeah.
And a lot of people will be scared here, like, oh, what about SEO if it runs, because React runs on the client side.
Right.
So what about like all?
So yeah, React doesn't just run on the client side. You can actually server-side render it or pre-render it. So there's basically two ways to do server-side rendering. One is pre-rendering, which means that you export to static HTML at build time. So every time your content changes, you have to rebuild. But the other is dynamically server-side rendering, which means like there's a request that comes in, and that request like calls the server, and the server will be like rendering the actual output.
Right. And then of course, if you can put some cache on top of it if you want to speed things up, right?
So if you want to speed it up, you can use a cache or like edge caching in certain environments.
So if I have my page, and I created all of that, then I break my page into different components for different things, and then I use React components. So basically, if we want to sum up, what are the things that Next brings to me, compared to using React alone?
So generally, if you want to use React, you have to set up a lot of different things. So for example, you have to know a little about compilation. So you have to figure out like how Webpack works. You have to set that up, for example, which is like Webpack is a bundler that like bundles all your code for a certain page. So you have a page that is in JavaScript, but it's like a newer version of JavaScript.
Mm-hmm.
You have to compile it using Babel, which means that it transforms your newer code to older code, basically. And then the React, like in terms of React, it means that you have to change like JSX, which is the HTML syntax for React,
to JavaScript.
Okay. And that's so also what Babel handles.
Right, all the building that you do out of the box for users.
Yeah, and then also, because it's not just compilation, right? You also have to like make sure that everything's optimized.
Mm.
And you have to, for example, learn about code splitting to make your make sure that your application is not just one giant JavaScript file. Where if you go to the homepage, it would like download your about page and your terms of service, which is this giant document.
So you do also the code splitting.
So Next.js by default code splits by routes. So every route is a different JavaScript bundle.
Nice. And also another thing that you, so we talked about code splitting, but what if there is a server rendering. So if I had to do the server rendering, then I had to have a node server, all these kind of things. Also, you provide that out of the box.
Right. So Next is built on top of Node.js, and then it uses the Node.js APIs to start up a server, for example, or you can use serverless. So it can do two things. It can build to a server and it can build to serverless. And the distinction there is that the serverless build will actually output serverless functions for you. So every page will become a different serverless function. And
so that, which means they can deploy it to a serverless...
to a serverless platform. So for example, ZetNow or like any other...
Or Lambda or all these kind of things. Right. So maybe in the next video, we'll focus more about some of the mechanics and also the AMP export that you told me before about.
Yes.
Cool. Thank you, Tim.
Thanks.